rain, when it dries and close works, yeah? So poor water on the running lake don't know what to do. And then it chews it away and it is new. So Neva is younger than ancient Greece. There were pyramids in Egypt. There was Parthenon in Athens. There was no Neva. So young city on a young place. It is situated in very, it's very low, yeah, on the level of the sea. That's why used to be a terrible floods in St. Petersburg. You see the most dangerous, the greatest flood of 1824. Probably you will read a poem of Pushkin, Bronze Falstein, and it happens during this flood. Slowly and gradually, city become higher and higher and higher as all cities. And now we have a special dam, Platina. Dam,
yeah,
in the sea, so it prevents us from the western wind is going. The river stopped here and blew away. So that's now, there are no floods now. We are the northmost big city, metropolitan city in the world. In the north direction are only Helsinki, Oslo, Stockholm, which are quite less population than St. Petersburg. St. Petersburg is 5 million population. And it is the 60th parallel. So it is not very pleasant places. Yeah? Greenland, North Canada, Siberia. It's like this. But what make our life more or less affordable is the Gulf Stream. You understand? So the climate is not as severe as in Siberia or in Canada, because the waters of the Baltic Sea received hot water from the Gulf Stream. So because we are situated in a deep north, we have these strange seasons, which are white nights and black days. White nights happen from May up to July, and you really can read the book in the night. And it's very beautiful because there is no people on the streets, and our city is such a severe city, she didn't like people at all. The less people, the more beautiful city we are. So those who survived the siege tell that it was unbelievably beautiful in the summer 1942, because millions of people died and there was nobody on the street or on the square. White night, it is a very pleasant time, but in the winter we have a very bad things. It is dark. I should say beginning from 4 o'clock. It is still dark at 9 o'clock in the morning when we are going to the work here. It is dark when we work from the work, returning home. And another thing is that it is not very cold, but very wet and very windy. So I shouldn't say that we are happy in the winter time. St. Petersburg would include 42 islands on this delta of Neva, and we have more bridges than any other city in the Europe, including Venice. Venice have more islands, we have more bridges. From May up to November, you can use water boards, and it's the best way to look at the city. One of the most prominent things and the thing which we are very proud of is that St. Petersburg, Leningrad, is the biggest old European city, in the sense that we have 15,000 apartment buildings which were erected before the First World War. Because St. Petersburg lost its position as a capital, it was not the growth of population as much, was much less than Moscow. As an example, St. Petersburg was something like 2.5 million of population in 1970, and now it's 5 million. And Moscow was something like around 2 million of population, and now it's 12 million. Another thing is that biggest European cities were ruined by bombs. Germany by British and American bombs, and London by Luftwaffe. Moscow and Paris were rebuilt. Paris by Napoleon III and Moscow by Stalin. So St. Petersburg has changed a lot. And it is a very strange thing. There is such impression. When you are walking through St. Petersburg, you is as you're walking through the Karatsin. Through decoration of some playwright in which he is not a hero. It's like living in Elsinore. So this is the where Raskolnikov was working, and it's everything all the places. And it was a capital, it was built as capital. So there is 12 small cities or the regiments of the guard with barracks and churches and so on. There are palaces of the great dukes, there are palaces of the emperors, they are useless. So in some sense it is such a mystical city. Biggest political force for the city is not about politics, it is about preservation of the city. So when somebody wants to ruin an old building which was built before 1940, even if it is ugly and build something new, everybody are against it. And what is interesting is that revolution against communism in Leningrad, because that meant I will tell it. But another thing is that these catastrophes which happened in St. Petersburg. It was a civil war in revolution. Now, up to the Second World War, city grew up here. Then it was a siege. And then slowly and gradually it disappeared. So the population was mostly changed 3 times in the period of the 20th century. It is the region of 1920 on the picture of Brzezinski. And it is a main memorial of the siege. It is a huge cemetery where something like 500,000 people are buried in what is not in private dumps here. They make rows over there, which these people anonymously. And it is also a monument of the siege. There was a small crematorium. It was even not a crematorium, but a factory which made bricks. Yeah? And they have this, I mean, the kitchen.
Chimneys,
yeah. So they put dead bodies there. And dead bodies were transported this is the first demonstration which happened in 1987. Remember, you met that in 1985 Gorbachev came to power, the situation became a bit more liberal, and we have a hotel in the downtown St. Petersburg, that's at St. Isaac Square, which is known as Angleterre. It was built in the end of the 19th century. It isn't very beautiful and very comfortable. It wasn't yet. But it was very well known in Russia because one of the most popular and probably the most handsome Russian poet, Yesenin, hanged himself, suicide.
Yeah.
So those who love Yesenin is very popular. I don't know to whom compare him in America, but it is almost Elvis Presley from a point of view of rarity. So if person knows some one poem, yeah, it's poem not of Pushkin, but of Yesenin. It's about love. So that's why people, especially young students from the group, underground group Starvation, they were against it, and they openly told that they will lay on the way of the tracks. And it was thousands of people. It was still communism, still Soviet power, and the soldiers of National Guard were hidden in the yards, and they just wait an order and then under arrest. But the situation changed. Gorbachev didn't want to begin his reign with the blood, and so he have told that the mayor come, who is a mayor, then she become a mayor of St. Petersburg, Prince and Matvey, and she told guys, go to the coast, the universities, nothing can happen. And immediately when they moved that way, explore the building. But they built just the same, so just the same building, but renovated. So it wasn't a tragedy. Probably, I will tell you, there was two big demonstrations, two big meetings during the Putin era in St. Petersburg. One was an idea of the so-named Gazprom Chapel. Gazprom is the biggest state-owned company which produces natural gas. Their headquarters are in and they wanted to build these headquarters as a
skyscraper.
Yeah, the biggest in Europe. And if they really erect it, all the views would be spoiled. You understand? Yeah. You could see, you always will see it. So my recommendation was not to look in the eastern direction. Because it had to be in the eastern direction, only in the western. But the demonstration was set so active that it was wrong to go back and step back. He built this chapel, but in another place, and it doesn't spoil the visual landscape. And these glacier, there were huge demonstrations against giving St. Isaac to Orthodox Church. We have in St. Isaac Cathedral, the main cathedral for official celebrating during the Tsarist era. Then it became a museum. And it is unbelievably popular because it is the main place where you can clip to cupola, and to look down. And you see all the city. It is 100 meters very tall, the biggest cathedral. So the Orthodox Church wanted back, and this means that the museum will be closed. And I should say, not the church, not the religion, but clergy, Orthodox clergy, is unpopular in St. Petersburg and in all these cities because they are with Catholics. because they're thinking more of money than about things. These huge cars, yeah, American or German, big houses, they are fat. So people doesn't want to give the museum to the church, but we have enough churches. And on the side of the church was a patriarch, chief of the church, who is very very influential, and he had a good relationship with Putin. And probably Putin was on his side, and government was on his side, but the demonstrations stopped. And up to our days, some days, still the museum, and you can visit it and look to the city. As we understand,
this is a question I had in concern to the clergy, the view of the clergy. Wasn't there a scandal recently about Patriarch Kirill having a Rolex watch?
Patriarch. Funny thing is that, yes, he had watched something like half a million dollars. And it was on the floor. And so, newspapers have told him. They immediately make another photo without watches, but still you can see the watches on the table. So there was always such difficult relations between Moscow and Saint Petersburg. I should say that in a way, Moscow is United States of America and Saint Petersburg is Great Britain. So it is one culture, but two types of a culture. Moscow is a very energetic city, which need hardworking people, and which give them a way to make their career opportunity. But that means that they will have to work from the morning to the evening. I don't know, going to fitness, and they have no time to read books, watch movies, and to discuss political matters, more or less. St. Petersburg is very lazy. In St. Petersburg, people have much less perspectives, and that's why they understand that they always will have some money to eat, to survive, probably to travel, because it is not very difficult. But human beings are not built in a square. They are not squirrels. So St. Petersburg seasons are even moving more slowly than Moscow. That's why St. Petersburg culture, Leningrad culture, in this century, or in the previous century, at the beginning of the our day century, is so successful because it is strange. Language. So I probably begins from Denis Harris, who was the first Russian surrealist and who invented surrealism before Janez Steinbecker. He was the first underground writer, not in the sense that he was writing something against Stalin, it was 1930. He was writing something absolutely impossible from the point of view of socialist realism, absolutely absurd. And as you understand, writing these things, he put him in risk himself in it. And he was very poor from this point of the Soviet standards. So the idea is that art and literature doesn't bring money. That's why you don't need to be a censorship. Yeah? And you doesn't and you even doesn't depend from auditorium. You don't need to be nice. You don't need to be simple. You need to be what you want. And I should say that less conservative Moscow spoils its writers much more than the very conservative St. Petersburg, because in Moscow there always is a way to compromise. and compromise spoil. You understand what I mean? I don't know, probably you will Russian literature. There was a lot of young, successful poets, especially in Moscow in the 60s, take it to Shenkov and Vysotsky. But they are losers, and Brodsky is winning. Because they have to write poems about Lenin. So if they want to publish something about freedom or about the world which they love, they have to give some concessions. Yeah? And Brodsky and Karamzin, all Leningrad people, they don't need to give concessions. Yeah? And that's why they were much stronger. He is Joseph Brodsky, who also wasn't published in the Soviet Union. He is a guitar lover. I have lectured about him yesterday. And this is the best known rock singer in Russia, Boris Grebenshchikov. I remember I'm more or less of the same age. And I remember his first underground concert. And there also was nothing, I should say, against the Soviet Union. It was just not like Soviet singers, absolutely. Absurdity, very difficult. He doesn't want to play with his listeners. Yeah? And still is the most popular and most sincere rock singer in Russia. It's the number one artist of our day, Sergei Shnurov. I highly recommend you to watch on YouTube his songs. They're very fine. Clips are unbelievably good. Just one was published when I was in America about elections of the mayor in a small provincial city. And he has a Schlager, yes?
Hit,
which is named Spitzeri Pit, to drink in the pit. The city of St. Peter. Also very funny. So in Russia,
not decent words.
In Russia, not decent words are prohibited. Everybody uses them, but officially it is prohibited. So you couldn't sing them on the courses or TV and radio is closed. So in any rhyme, that's
Trishka.
Line. In any line of Putin, of Schneider, any such word. Yeah? So it's not for kids, I should say. The kids adore him. Because it's against the teachers in a way. Yeah. So he chose the road, which was the road not on the plain, but in the mountains, yeah? Because he couldn't use TV and everything else. So it was other old concerts, and with the beginning of the internet era, he dumped a YouTube series, yeah? And he is very successful in the business. He's the richest musician in Russia. Because everybody wants his concerts, and now they just couldn't address him. They give him pause. And it always is like a stadium, so 100,000 of listeners and so something like that. He visited me while New York City several months ago. And also, it was mainly Russian immigrants, but Anglo-Saxons also loved him. Yeah.
Was rock and roll ever considered to be a capitalist thing by the Soviet authorities?
First it was jazz. Then jazz was rehabilitated in the 50s. Then it was rock and roll. They use rock and roll. They invent Soviet rock and roll. It wasn't just named rock and roll, but it was rock and roll. But mostly it was in the underground. It is a typical Leningrad scholar who received the prize of field, which is the biggest prize, like Nobel Prize in maths. And he declined to take it. So it will take a time, I don't need money, go away. So they go away with his $1 million. And he's living in, no, now he's living in Sweden. Then he was living in such not very rich part of Leningrad. If you will visit our city, you will see these prominent places. Okay. First of all, it is State Heritage, which is situated in Winter Palace, Palace of the Russian Empire, and four buildings of the Hermitage. Hermitage is a museum which was founded by Catherine the Great. In the end of the 18th century, antiques were very cheap because French Revolution happened. And aristocrats want to sell it. And Russia was unbelievably rich in this moment. So she buy everything she can. That's why a Hermitage is the biggest art museum in Europe. I don't know how, I think in the world too, it is much bigger than Metropolitan. Though we have sold in the end of the 20s and beginning of the 30s, 50 pictures to the West during the industrialization, and you can see them in the National Gallery in Washington and Metropolitan and in this world. Still we have the greatest collection of Rembrandt in the world. We have good Spanish art, we have unbelievable impressionists, and we have a lot of armor, because next to Chronicles the first, he was, you know, last Boy Scout. He wanted to collect military things, military objects. It is a very difficult museum, I should say, because it is situated not in the building which was erected for museum, but for in the palace. Yeah. So I have such a horror dream when I was a schoolboy that I am skilled up as though. I'm late to go away from museum. And I am in the night in museum. like labyrinth.
Stay beyond closing.
Yeah. I couldn't find the exit. I'm lost. So when you will go to Hermitage, you will visit Hermitage. You have to decide what do you want to see, and see to only this thing. Other, it will be a headache. So only mummy. I like mummies. Mummy in the night. That's pity. Or in noir, but not really. Much more comfortable is the Russian Museum, the biggest collection of national art, which was situated in the palace of the great Duke. Drama theaters it is a special field, and in Moscow probably drama theaters are better than in St. Petersburg, but we have more or less equal opera and ballet, musical theater. Ballet now probably is a little bit better in Moscow than Bolshoi Theater, but opera is the best in Greece. St. Petersburg is surrounded by some estates of the emperors. Most of them were destroyed during the Second World War, but they were restored in 40s, 50s, and 60s. So the most beautiful probably is Tsarskoye Selo. It is Palkalovsk, the best English park in the Europe, better than in Riga. It is Gatchina, the residence of Alexander III, the first such gloomy place, I should say, vertical a little bit. It is Strena, this palace belongs now to Mr. Putin. It's his official residence, it's not something which he hiding. And it is a Petrov with 250 fontaines like in the west side. Lindenbaum is a place where you have Yep.
Is it true that both, I believe it was Paul II and Catherine...
He's not second Paul's.
Oh, well, the Tsar who preceded Catherine the Great.
Yeah.
Isn't it true that he would actually order his soldiers to move around like toy soldiers?
You know, we know about Peter III, this thing, from the memoirs of Catherine the Great. Catherine the Great ordered to kill him. So it was in her interest to write that he was foolish, crazy, idiot, scoundrel, and so on. So she did it. So it's not the single source. Meanwhile, Peter the Third have finished their torture in Russian prisons. He liberated the nobility. The nobility can now resign when it wants. He gave freedom to all believers. It was part of the Orthodox Church. So he was very effective. So I think she's lying. So, St. Petersburg Kuzyn is our city situated on the water, on the river, and on the sea. We prefer to put zakusa.
So it's thick, but it's also like a chaser, you know? Like when you shot and then you chase it with something.
Yeah. By something with the fish. It is our national fish, which they smelt. And every spring there is this smell of cucumber, because it smells like cucumber. And in all kitchens, they prepare every family in its own way. And our male population is crazy about fishing from the ice, you know, they make holes. So you go, it is more about drinking vodka with buddies. But they, when they come back, where they have some three or four fishes. It is sprat. It is, I should say, it is like, what? Like hamburger in St. Petersburg. It is salt in any dining. And it is lumpy, it is a little bit more aristocratic, it is something in between snake and fish. Yeah. St. Petersburg, I have told you that Shnurov sing that Peter repeats, drink in the Peter. So St. Petersburg is the city of the pubs. In the cold weather, in the time of the cold weather, you have to move from St. Petersburg, you know, as a soldier out of the fire. This pub, this bookstore, then I don't know, this coffee house, then pub, and so on. Because you have to hide from the wind, and so on. So we have a lot of very, very cheap places where every student can drink what he wants and drink what he wants. Over a good level, I should say. What is the difference between Moscow and St. Petersburg? That in the Moscow, probably the luxury restaurants are better. There, you have to pay unbelievable money. But still they have, I don't know, the best Brazilian restaurant in the world, something like that. But the usual place are impossible from my point of view. They are very costly, very dirty, and with a very strange custom. In St. Petersburg, if you have 1,000 rubles, which is 1,000 rubles, it is $20, $25. If you have $25, you always will find a dinner, which consists of soup. I should say that students, graduate students, young intellectuals prefer bars. It's more about beer. Yeah? We have a lot of sorts of our own beer, and especially of our own cider, which is made from apples. Yeah? British and Irish pubs are unbelievably popular. And this is named Rumichna, which is a place where you just drop a vodka and eat some fish, small fish, with your friend. It's a Russian type of the pub. So when the work is finished, yeah, men, it's mostly a male thing, yeah, they're on the way back home, they discuss football and politics in Rumichna. St. Petersburg was only twice smaller than it was before the revolution than it is now. So even after the siege, after the Civil War, there is a lot of antics in the hands of the people, sometimes very poor people. So it is a city of those who make collections. If you is a student, you can begin with, I don't know, Leningrad Parsley or something else. But there is thousands of antique shops, of cheap antique shops. And there is a huge flea market where also all collectors gather and look for these curious things. The most popular slogan in St. Petersburg is one city, one team. And this one team is Zenit, which was 3 years ago, which was 5-time champion of Soviet Union. And always these fights between Moscow teams, Spartak, CSKA, and Dynamo, and Zenit, there it is a real battle. Sometimes fans are beating each other. Red and white fans of Spartak shield the city, and blue and the Globoi.
Light blue.
Yeah, and white Zenit. They meet each other in the yards, in the gardens, so it's time to hide and to watch it on TV. A very pleasant thing is that when, after 1987, the borders slowly and gradually were opened, we have an possibility to travel abroad, and it is not very difficult. The consulate of Finland in St. Petersburg give 1 million visas, Schengen visas, every year. So I think that 90% of the population of St. Petersburg have traveled to Europe. Finland is a part of the European Union. And we have a very big have a very big influence toward the spirits of St. Petersburg citizens. We become much more better in the sense of ecology, I should say. So Leningrad was like a dirty city. Now we're a very clean city. Just because it is an experience. Finland is the best ecological country in Europe. Probably Canada is better, a little bit than both. So when you smoke, you think about place where you have to put the cigarette after. And Russians are very gifted. They learn very quickly. So Finland isn't very. The best for those who love nature. It's not a country of big cities and great architecture, but it's a country of 1,000 lakes, as they put it, of deep forests, of fishing, of hunting, and so on. On another border, there is Estonia, which is a small, comfortable, little bit igrushne.
Yeah,
you
know, play the toy, the plaything.
Toy-like, yeah. Country with unbelievably beautiful medieval city of Tallinn. So if we will have possibility to travel to St. Petersburg, we will give you American passport and cross the border in 1 hour in Finland and 3 hours in Tallinn. And there is also a cruise, yeah? Stockholm, Helsinki, St. Petersburg, Tallinn, Stockholm. So it's it. If you have questions, and I think you have asked me. So you're not interested in my city.
We're so enthralled with you, we're just speechless. Somebody's got questions, but that you're just too embarrassed to ask.
That's right. There is a very strong regionalist movement in St. Petersburg. Something like in Catalonia or in Scotland. There is the idea to not become independent, but become an autonomous part of the Russian Federation, which would include not only St. Petersburg, but also in the neighboring district, Novgorod, Moscow, and the Karelian region. Yeah.
But based on what? I mean, Catalonia is clearly an ethnic thing. But there's no, I mean, Petersburgers are Russians.
Don't remember how United States were made.
Well, yes.
Sorry.
Yeah. How is it possible that St. Petersburg became known as the old city? I mean, in America, we're like a pretty young country, and we have some cities that are older than St. Petersburg. And the way you say it seems like St. Petersburg.
Older, in the sense that it is mostly Victorian and modern. It's not built in the 20th century. You can walk through a city miles and miles and miles, and you will don't see anything which is built after 1949. So it's not old in the sense of, I don't know, Cervantes or Shakespeare, but it is old in the sense of Conan Doyle. He was walking through Conan Doyle, of Jack London City. The city of the beginning of the 20th century. Yeah.
This is a question about the cuisine.
Mm-hmm.
How expensive are lampreys, and what's a good drink that people have with
them?
How expensive?
Сколько стоит чего?
Да, как сколько
A bottle of vodka is something like $5. So you can drink.
No, I meant the lamprey.
What is lamprey?
Lamprey, the eel, snake.
Absurdista.
The rybista.
I don't know, it's a question to my wife. Because I buy things only in restaurants and cafes, and I don't know what is how much money they cost in the store. I think it is more costlier than other fishes, because it is a delicatessen. You wouldn't eat it every day. You have to go to the special shop, go to the market, and buy it there. So it is luxury.
Yes. Who are the most common foreign tourists in St. Petersburg?
Oh, it changed. First of all, it was Finns, as you understand. There was a very good relationship between Finland and Soviet Union, and they have possibility to travel for weekends. And because Finland was a social democratic party, they have these social benefits. So it was mostly for free, something like that. Then the communism died, there was a lot of Germans, a lot of Italians, a lot of Americans. Now, when relationships spoiled, and we know that we have these problems with business, the China, our now market, the majority of the tourists, this summer were from China. And the whole infrastructure is made for Chinese tourists. I mean, Chinese restaurants, which is owned by Chinese, Chinese stores, which are owned by Chinese. So the city isn't happy because money is going to, the money of Chinese tourists are returning China. Nothing is inside. Well, there is a cultural tourism. There is some events every year. I would highly recommend you the holiday, which is named Ali Bursa, the Red
Scarlet Sails.
There is a short story by the writer Green about romantical heroes, and in the end, the heroine on this special ship with the red kills come to Captain Ray. So it is a holiday of graduation of high school. And you can see tens of thousands of drunken schoolboys. It's not very pleasant. But still, on the Neva, it is unbelievably beautiful. This plaza show and this ship which is going, and it is on the TV screens all over the country, and the president always is there because it is his native city. So I am waiting during some bit. Thank you very much. It's a private institution. I have founded something which is named House Culture of the Revolution. We use, in Soviet time, there was such an institution, House of Culture. It was an institution where you for free can learn English, or I don't know, make small planes, or or you can dance if you is older, yeah, and find girlfriend. And there was always a movie theater and theater. But after capitalism comes, the majority of these houses were privatized. So the idea was to organize something which will replace these houses of culture. But we also have to make money. That's why it is a system of excursions, yeah? Mm-hmm. Guided excursions, and we prefer those who have visited St. Petersburg. So we don't need to go with to Hermitage or to Russian Museum, but to Leningrad of Harms, of St. Petersburg, of Dostoevsky, and so on. We have system of lectures, and we invite the best lectures in the city, and sometimes lectures over from Moscow. We have meetings with the prominent people from Moscow and other countries. Dmitry Bykov, who was here on my position several years ago, was lecturing in our House of Culture. Now we have a very profitable and very successful program for kids. It is teaching kids humanitarian things. One week in the Peterhof Fortress. They are living in Peterhof Fortress. They are shooting from cannons in Peterhof Fortress and so on. And also we have a forces of guides. So that's it. They do feed us.
Yeah.
Oh, homework. I had your homework.
So did you see your engraver?
For what?
For Russian.
No.
If you go into the studio, you can look at grades like
that. Oh, no problem.
I'll talk to you in that meeting.
Yeah, sir.